Hey y'all, it's me again, and I just need to get some stuff off my chest real quick. Go here if you just want the damn list. I've got a confession to make. I've lately become so tired of worst lists. Like, okay, I can see how they're fun theoretically. There are always going to be those songs that we, as pop music lovers, absolutely despise, or at the very least, we're just utterly baffled by. It can be kind of fun to let out a little bit of steam as a creator, and it can also be enlightening and even entertaining to see how other reviewers admit their frustrations. But also, it can get so very tedious. I gotta be honest, I haven't really enjoyed these past few worst lists I've made. And yes, much of that could be due to the vapidity of the material. Some years' bad hits are bad in that funny kind of way, while others are just utterly soulless. It's simply the luck of the draw there. But just by virtue of these lists' intentions, we gotta dwell on the negative for an entire video's length, and, well, it can be so tiresome. Now, there have been a few rewarding experiences making these worst lists. For example, my recent collaboration with Sean allowed us to bounce our thoughts off each other, and we ended up with a rather cool set of videos in the end. But when I'm all alone with my discontent, flailing messily for all to see, well, it's just not fun for me anymore. I've even humored the idea of copying my friend Crow from Cacophony and just askew detailed worst lists altogether. They seem to be having a fun time doing exactly that. Go subscribe to Crow, by the way. At the same time though, I know I can't realistically do that if I expect my channel to grow. I mean, just a cursory glance down my most popular videos shows that, besides the aforementioned videos with Sean and Best of Current Year, my worst lists are very clearly my most popular videos, and I'm pretty certain it's not just my list specifically. The culture of online media criticism just tends to skew towards the outrageously negative. It is a bit depressing to know that I can't have it both ways, and essentially I have to choose between my own satisfaction and the growth of my channel, into which I've already poured so much time. But that's the way it is, I guess. Therefore, I think the most efficient middle ground for me would be shorter, simpler, lower effort worst list videos from this point onward. I just no longer see the point in pulling my hair out with worst lists, all for the attention of viewers who may or may not come back to visit the videos I actually enjoy making. And to be honest, I'm being extremely transparent about it right now because I'm curious to see if it'll make a difference. Will the view count of my videos plummet once people realize I'm purposefully half-assing them for my own sanity? Something tells me it won't, but I'll just have to wait and see. Anyway, all of this is to say, I haven't exactly been looking forward to covering the bad music of 1999. I'll have a more proper, less whiny intro to the year once I get around to my best list, but all I gotta say right now is the stuff we're dealing with today lies in the boring, soul-sucking side of the charts. There were, however, at least a few songs that gave me something substantial to discuss, such as... So let me get the obvious out of the way. This song was recorded for the soundtrack of the Rugrats movie, and it sure as hell reminds you of this fact every chance it gets. I haven't watched Rugrats in a very long time, but I do know that one of its most iconic aspects is Mark Mothersbaugh's theme music, which they have heavily incorporated into this song's instrumental, and I think that's pretty cute. In general, it's a rather innocuous little soundtrack song, just something to fill that want for a child-friendly tune pleasant enough to play both on the radio and over the end credits of a cartoon film. But the thing is, it might be a little too innocuous. These lyrics are corny as hell and come off as if an actual child had wrote them. Which, okay, yeah, fitting. But I'm not sure if that really makes for good pop music. Maya was never a particularly strong performer, at least not in this stage of her career, but she's always worked rather well as backup for stronger, more dominant performers. Here, she's given a lot of the center stage and it just doesn't work all that well. Blackstreet are... fine. Both guest rappers are... fine. I don't know, I wouldn't make the lyrical corniness such a big factor to my disliking this, but there's really nothing else to sink my teeth into here. This just hasn't aged well at all, certainly not outside the context of its film soundtrack. Oh, and speaking of film soundtracks... You told me to run, you told me to fly, help me to free the me. So here's another one of those play this over the end credits songs, but where Take Me There is going for something on the cutesier side, this song aims for a more inspirational angle. Music of the Heart comes from the biopic of the same name, which was apparently a big deal at the time. It stars Meryl Streep and was directed by, I shit you not, Wes Craven. Yes, that Wes Craven. I don't know what to do with this information, but anyway, that's neither here nor there. I likely don't need to tell y'all this, but this is little more than a blatant cash grab from all corners of its existence. Inspirational pop ballad? Check. Then super popular boy band singers to grab the young market? Check. Legendary songstress feature to attract the older market? Check. Non-threatening lyrics set along a meandering melody? And a key change? Oh yeah. This song was produced by David Foster, the man behind some of the most insipid power ballads throughout the 80s and 90s. Yes, that includes a lot of Chicago. Ugh. This track falls into that mix, but not in any particularly interesting way. You're currently listening to this as background music to my soothing voice, but I can assure you, you're literally not missing a single thing that you couldn't get in like 20 other songs of its ilk. As for the song itself, this was written by legendary songwriter Diane Warren, who I have much more positive things to say about. She's written some of the most legendary ballads in the field, and her talent in that regard is certainly commendable. On the other hand, she's also written some of the most trite, malnourished love songs to ever become hits. This is one of them, just tired love song cliches piled atop each other, strung together by that bizarrely feathery chorus melody. It tries as little as possible and succeeds? Yeah, let's call it that. But I guess this should maybe come as no surprise. I mean, this is Diane Warren we're talking about. The woman who gave us this? I don't wanna close my eyes. I don't. Alright, so I guess I should explain a few things here. There was this odd trend throughout the 90s where a song would get huge traction on pop radio, and then, inexplicably, a cover version would be recorded and released specifically for country sales and airplay. I Don't Wanna Miss a Thing was one of the most prominent examples of such, with the Aerosmith version reaching smash success just a year prior. Now, I have a lot of nostalgia for the original recording of the song, but despite this, yeah, I know it's not great. It's so incredibly overwrought, and on a bad day, absolutely headache-inducing. I could stay awake just to hear you breathing. Mark Chestnut's version certainly tones everything down a lot, replacing that giant pop rock spectacle with more toned-down adult contemporary instrumentation. The end result is a really, really boring song. Just the blandest, most milquetoast love song imaginable. Goes to show that the most ridiculous aspects of Aerosmith's version may have actually lent to that recording's strengths. But as for what I still like about this cover, I mean, I've always been a fan of that melody. I genuinely think it's quite pretty, and it likely serves as the bulk of the song's appeal. But then that leads us to the biggest problem of the track, which is Mark Chestnut himself. Then I kiss your eyes, and thank God we're together. I feel like this would have probably sounded passable on the car radio during a casual afternoon drive in 1999, but nowadays it's clear that this is one of the worst abuses of autotune I've ever heard in a pop song. Every moment spent with you is a moment I... It just totally takes me out of the song altogether. It's so distracting. I'm glad that producers have figured out how to utilize this implement more gracefully, because this is just atrocious. Ugh. Anyway, outside of this quirky little annoyance, there really isn't much else to say about this one, so let's move on. What's next? From this moment, life has begun. Yep, another ballad. Don't worry, it's not gonna be all ballads from this point on. I'm not that sadistic. So this song finds Shania Twain at her absolute peak. We're 2 years separated from the giant record-breaking success of Come On Over, yet still only 4 singles deep out of 12? Jesus Christ. Yeah, even considering that the late 90s were a generally excellent commercial peak for country pop, Shania Twain was absolutely huge for this time and would continue to be into the new millennium. From this moment on was a follow-up ballad to You're Still the One, which became Twain's first top 10 hit on the pop charts. I'll say this, of the two, You're Still the One is far more captivating, lyrically and sonically. I just love the theme of a relationship overcoming trials and tribulations to come out the other side even stronger, and it makes for a more poignant love song as a result. From this moment, I have been blessed. From this moment on, however, is an absolute slog. Theoretically, I can see how this hazy, dreamy sonic atmosphere might be appealing, and sure, it kinda is. Or at least it is until the second verse. From this moment, as long as I lean, I... At that that point, the production abandons the more interesting spaciousness of the start and settles for more generic adult contemporary bombast, and that just kind of sucks. I'm not sure if I ever noted this on this channel, but while I do enjoy a lot of love songs, I tend to be pretty turned off by those that are intrinsically tied to marriage. It's just not something that's exactly a priority for me, so I feel a lot more of a disconnect with the rhetoric of such songs. And that's another reason why I prefer You're Still the One. There's a substantial love narrative there that pays no mind to the finality of marriage. With From This Moment On, that's the entirety of the song. I can't wait to live my life with you. I can't wait to start. The words are never explicitly spoken, but it's pretty damn clear that this was written with the wedding crowd in mind, and that artificiality just bores me to tears. And speaking of things that bore me to tears, your love is like a river, peaceful and deep. Your soul is like... Okay, yeah, we've been here before, but I could not let these boys get away with this again. So I should note that while NSYNC are not my personal favorite of the boy band sweepstakes, that being the Backstreet Boys, they certainly had their fair share of bops. However, it's also true that, unlike BSB, it took a little while for those bops to come into light. I mean, we've still got a few months until No Strings Attached slams its way into the public consciousness, but that's a story for another day. In the meantime, we've got the boys fumbling around for a few years, trying on a few hats to see what feels right. And yeah, that also means we get some tepid adult contemporary ballads. Obviously. I'm gonna keep this short because, well, what exactly do you want me to say here? This is music for dentist offices, plain and simple. It also further demonstrates just how much of a stranglehold these slow ballads had on the pop airwaves at the time. It's very basic for the most part, except for the conceit of its title, which I just find so stupid. God must have spent a little more time on you. God must have spent a little more time on you. That's something you tell a 5-year-old to explain why they're so special just the way they are, not something used to impress a romantic partner. It's just silly. And oh yeah, remember when I said that there was this phenomenon in the 90s where big pop hits would often get their own country song cover? Your love is like a river, peaceful and deep. Yep. This was another one of the big ones, covered by 70s southern rock band Alabama of all acts. Meh, anyway, I don't have time for this anymore. Okay, now can we have something a little more interesting? Please? My love is all I have to give. Without you, I don't think I can. Okay, so here's the thing. I can see it in your eyes. Adult contemporary became one of the most prominent music types through the 80s, bolstered by an open market of listeners, i.e. older listeners, feeling increasingly alienated by the newer, more radical genres coming from the MTV age. As the marketability of AC bled into the 90s, it became much more common for mainstream pop and R&B singers to dip their toes into adult contemporary, usually in the form of love songs. This is why seemingly every pop star around this time seemed to have at least one or two sluggish ballads in their repertoire for every handful of upbeat pop hits. And since Boyz II Men were one of the biggest names to primarily make slower, polished ballads, it was only natural that this would bleed over to the other boy bands of the decade. And they were all pretty bad. And yeah, I know that I said I was Team Backstreet earlier, but 9 times out of 10, their ballads just do not work. Additionally, they're all totally indistinguishable from one another. If you listen to All I Have to Give, you basically listen to them all. Well, okay, except I Want It That Way. That one's a banger. But you gotta wade through the rest of the treacly sludge first. I don't even know what to say at this point. This is as dull and flavorless from the first listen as it is with the 20th. Not to mention that it's led by that tried and cursed theme of "my love is worth more than all the gifts your shitty boyfriend gives you." I would call it tasteless if it even bothered to have any flavor whatsoever. This is also one of the weakest climaxes of the entire list. It's actually pretty funny. Presents this illusion of grandiose emotional swell at that ending, but still remains too thin and wispy to have much of an emotional punch. Not to mention these lyrics, which look pretty on paper, but are effectively meaningless. If you're gonna go to the hyperbolic romantic statement route, you better sell the hell out of it. Which is definitely not what's going on here. Oh, will you look at that? More Lizette poison. I do cherish you for the rest. Okay, are y'all starting to see why I didn't want to do this list? This is one of those years where the bad songs are the ones that try the very least to be anything at all. There aren't any vocal or lyrical performances in particular bad taste or instrumentation that is dated in that, wow, I can't believe this was cool at the time kind of way. Just the most cookie cutter stuff imaginable. And to be fair, I did choose this year specifically because of the stuff I actually loved. Not to say that the best list will be exceptionally cool or anything, but it'll be a hell of a lot better than this crap. Pretty much everything I've had to say about every other dismal boy band ballad applies here, but I don't know, somehow this feels a lot worse than the others. And I think it's due to the unholy combination of the lyrics and performance of such. If you're asking, do I love you this much? I do. This is another one of those songs that have marriage as an implied theme, so I'd already not care for it on that front. And yeah, these lines fall into those Hallmark card hyperboles that I just don't care for. It also doesn't help that the performers of 98 Degrees are on total autopilot for the length of the song. At least with the NSYNC songs, Justin and JC do a pretty decent job at elevating their maudlin source material with half-interesting vocal performances. Here we've got Nick Lachey, who is unbearably boring. Absolutely nothing to grasp onto with this one, not even a chorus that sticks to the brain in any way. It's not even annoying, it just slides off completely. Do I even need to say anything more at this point? Okay, apparently I do. So, usually I like to say that one shouldn't pay much mind to the ordering of these lists. I mean, let's be real, most of these songs could be blindly rearranged with little fuss. But despite how samey all these ballads are, and they certainly are, this one rings a little bit extra bad, at least for me. And since Joey McIntyre was previously a member of New Kids on the Block, this also follows the trend of those insipid ballads from boy bands, or at least boy band members. Again, I don't hate boy band cuts on principle, there are just a lot of really bad ones here. And I hope you always stay the same. It might be tempted to say that Stay the Same blends in neatly with the collection of all these other songs from this year, and even this decade, but in actuality, it is so much worse. Don't you ever say you don't like the way you are. I just really hate the trend of speakers telling their partners that they should never change because they're so perfect just the way they are, as if any one person could ever make that call. So that sucks. But also, while many of the songs I previously talked about tend to fall totally limp and lifeless in their efforts at courting their listeners, Stay the Same, on the contrary, tries way too damn hard. Joey McIntyre really, really wants you to never change, and he's willing to shatter his vocal cords to make sure you know this. It's just a lot. Like, it's almost admirable at just how obviously bad this is from the first listen. But with that in mind, it sure wouldn't be a worst of 1999 list without... I don't know how you do what you do. I'm so in love with... Yeah, it's Oops All Ballads for this list. Also, just to make this clear, I know that this is technically more of a 2000 hit since that was the year in which it mostly charted and peaked at number one for 3 weeks. I don't care, I'm already starving for material as is. And spoilers for worst of 2000, I guess? Anyway, all you've heard about the song is certainly true. It's incredibly cloying and syrupy, certainly in all the worst possible ways. But what sets it over the edge for me are these lyrics. Dear lord, these lyrics. The smell of your skin, the taste of your kiss, your hair all around me, baby, you surround me, you touch every place in my heart. I'm being serious when I say I'm in absolute disbelief that adults wrote these lines. Romantic hyperbole is one thing, this is just word salad at this point. I don't know if it's necessarily true to call Lone Star a boy band, but this certainly feels like a standard shitty boy band anthem in all but name. Not to mention that this is another wedding first dance anthem, which is just a wonderful cherry atop this all. Ugh, this song simply bores me to tears. Maybe I'll have more to say on this at some other point, maybe not, probably not. I don't think it deserves any further significant portion of my time and effort. I just hate it. Baby, I'm amazed by you. Now, for the absolute worst song of the year. By the way, when I said earlier that this list wasn't going to be all ballads, I wasn't lying. Because, well, let me introduce y'all to Sporty Thieves.
Franchise. Nada. Shot caller. Yeah, Sporty Thieves.
Oh, yeah.
A pigeon is a girl who be walking by. My ramped up blue, brand new sparkling five. Her feet hurt, so you know she want to ride.
Ugh, okay. Obviously, we're dealing with a whole different beast in this entry. And I feel that a little bit of background info might be necessary.
Scrub is a guy that thinks he's flying this.
I doubt I need to tell y'all most of this, but this is No Scrubs by TLC. It was huge in its day and widely considered one of the quintessential releases of Y2K era pop music. In terms of lyrics, the women of TLC recount moments wherein random men have unsuccessfully tried picking up on them, using the term scrub to imply that, yes, these men are deadbeats and therefore not worth their time. And of course, the random men took that very, very personally. Apparently, No Pigeons wasn't the only response song made of TLC's hit, but it was the only one that charted to a considerable degree, mainly thanks to a push in radio play bolstered solely by the song's novelty appeal. And like, this is probably the basest definition of missing the point that I've ever seen in a response song. You see, the women of TLC were recounting what we assume are personal experiences with the men they've turned down. Men that, as the chorus makes clear, are actively trying to hit on them. In No Pigeons, we know two things are clear. One, the women in which these speakers are rapping about aren't interested in going home with them, as evident in their self-placement as the subjects of No Scrubs.
Thought she said thug, but she called me a scrub. Scrub? What?
At the same time though, it doesn't seem like these guys are that interested either, given their general distaste for these women.
I don't want no pigeon to be them girls who gets no dub from me.
So then why waste the energy writing, performing, and recording this song in the first place? The answer to that is overwhelming insecurity.
This ain't my Benz, this my man's, yeah. But this ain't my car, like that ain't your hair.
You see, this follows the age-old tradition of men being so enraptured by whom they see as the prettiest girl in the room, until she turns them down, after which she's suddenly the meanest, coldest, ugliest bitch who ever lived. Every woman and female presenting person knows this experience so well, including those who aren't even attracted to men in the first place. And this is that exact scenario, presented unfiltered and entirely through the man's perspective. And it's as uncomfortable as it sounds.
Your flat ass gets enough laughs. Take it to the salon, pluck your mustache.
See, there's a very important phrase that I think a lot of people should keep in mind when encountering criticism supported by experience. That phrase being, if it don't apply, let it fly. Of course, all forms of bigotry deserve to be called out when it happens, but I'm talking more like someone giving their own personal perspectives on some relatively harmless matter, and a random observer taking it way, way too personally. Essentially, the internet in a nutshell. And that's totally what's going on here. Like, I'm far from the best person to be having this conversation, but there's a case to be made about No Scrubs being a response to the virulent misogyny and rap music lyrics over the previous decade plus. TLC didn't just decide to hate men one day, their words came with a precedent. This song, however, is just flagrantly unpleasant insults piled atop each other, presented via weak bars, boring performances, and, well, they didn't really need to sing.
Wanna smoke with me with no money? Oh no, I don't want no.
But I guess we can't always get what we want. Also, pigeons? Really? What a stupid fucking analogy. I hate it so much. This is garbage, and certainly the worst hit song of 1999. Alright, now that that's over with, we can finally move on to the fun stuff. Before I go, though, I'd like to give one last special thank you to my viewers over at Patreon. For as low as $1 per video, you can become a patron of mine and help support my channel. $3 will get your name at the end of my videos, or sometimes a start, alongside these other names that you are reading right now. If you want to step up even further, join the $5 tier for early access to each one of my videos. Link is down in the description to join. Thank you kindly. And thanks to all of you for watching. Best of 99 should be coming very soon. It's gonna be a fun time. Until then, take care of yourselves, and I'll see you all later. Bye.